Ariella, you're on. Ariella, we have a standard guest speaker arrangement where each student gets a chance to read your bio.
Oh, that's how it goes?
So you're on. This is your life.
That's a waste of time.
That's all right.
They can read it just now.
Go ahead.
All right, thank you very much.
Do it quickly. Okay. Ronald Gutman was born in Brussels, Belgium, where he attended the Conservatory of Dramatic Arts as well as the University of Law. After beginning his professional acting career in Belgium, he moved to the United States at the age of 25 to pursue his studies. He continued working in theater in New York, Paris, and Los Angeles, and ultimately transitioned into predominantly TV and film work. He began producing about 10 years ago when he founded his production company, Highbrow, which focuses on nurturing and providing resources for independent film and theater during the critical stages of development from concept to completion. Highbrow is currently a producer on the acclaimed off-Broadway show My Name is Asher Lev, playing at the West Side Theater through September 1st. Past credits include off-Broadway, The Man Who Ate Michael Rockefeller, Masked, which had a Drama Desk Award nomination, Die, a Lucille Lortel Award, and Christine Jorgensen Reveals, which got a Drama Desk Award. Mr. Gutman has also co-produced the independent films 30 Beats, Tickling Leo, and The Toll Booth, and the documentaries Deceptive Practice, The Mystery and Mentors of Ricky Jay, Destiny Hills, and New York Street Games. Alongside his production credits, Mr. Gutman continues his lifelong vocation as an actor. Recent credits include Pawn, CBS's The Good Wife, AMC's Mad Men, and HBO's Mildred Pierce. Mr. Gutman will appear in the upcoming films Imogene with Kristen Wiig, and Nina with Zoe Saldana. This July, Mr. Gutman will assume the role of Woland in a stage adaptation of Mikhail Bulgakov. I'm sorry.
That's good. There's a lot of foreign words there for you. It's challenging, you valedictorian person. You have to learn how to pronounce foreign names. Mikhail Bulgakov.
Mikhail
Bulgakov.
Okay.
Woland. Uh-huh. I'm just kidding. You're doing great.
Thank you. So it's The Master and the...
And Margarita. It's
okay.
A novel.
As part of Bard Summerscape 2013.
Yeah.
Further acting credits can be found at imdb.com.
Thank you, Ariel. Round of applause.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Now, before we begin, we actually did put a reel together.
Now I want to see myself.
And we're going to see
it over there.
And I just want you to know that I asked Ronald before we start today's workshop that he would select one piece that we could open up with and you can look at. And which piece are we going to start off with?
Discover that.
Oh, we just want to see what's on the menu first. I'm sorry. Yeah. Oh, this is it. Okay.
That's good. Just go ahead.
Reel.
Oh, that's my reel, so that's the whole thing.
Okay, we'll do the reel.
20 years of my life in 5 minutes. That's very funny. Vincenzo, vieni a prendermi con la macchina.
That wasn't my intention, but certainly if Vida did.
Listen, you. You seem like a sensible lady, no? You go to a zoo, huh? See little snake? He's from India. He's all red, yellow, black. Very pretty little snake. You take home? Huh? Make little pet like puppy dog? No. You got more sense. I tell you, it is the same with these Vida. You buy ticket, you look at the little snake, but you not take home. No.
What are you insinuating? That my daughter is a snake?
No, it's coloratura soprano. It's much worse. Madame. His special fancy breed, like a blue Persian cat, come once in a lifetime, sing all in the trill, staccato, cadenza, a tough stuff, cost like her. And this girl is coloratura.
She's a wonderful girl.
No, is wonderful singer. The girl is something else.
Is this your passion?
Pourquoi tu me parles en anglais?
Because you have changed. I always thought you were very single-minded about your dreams and that would help you through life. But now I see that you skipped the struggle and went right to the end.
It's not the end, it's the beginning.
This apartment, this wealth that someone handed to you, this was what Karl Marx was talking about. And it's not because someone else deserves it. It's because it is bad for your soul.
Don't beat me with your politics because you hate that I love Don.
No, I hate that you give up. Don't let your love for this man stop you from doing what you wanted to do.
This is wrong, Papa.
D'accord, ma chérie? Bonsoir.
600,000 on number 30.
Good luck.
Number 13 did not shoot.
What the fuck are you doing? Pull that trigger. Shoot. Shoot, you son of a bitch.
Bon, on n'a pas besoin d'écouter davantage.
Il y a dit ça maintenant.
Excuse me. We are not stumbling our way through anything, and we ask that you show our defense its due respect.
My apologies, madam.
We have come here not to be prejudged.
Yes, you're right.
We are looking at an arrière-pensée for this persecution.
I believe the defendant has already been allowed an extended break.
Appellant?
I believe this panel can allow the appellant time to prepare for their attaque au fait.
Merci, monsieur.
Please, do you have any idea of the importance of the concert tomorrow night for August?
August?
Wait, listen. You gotta tell me right now, is this man really your father? You can tell me the truth. Is he your father?
Friday.
Do I give a shit? And Torah says you can't light a fire on Shabbos because it's work, correct?
No.
But if alternating current is running through the wires every second of every day and I turn on a switch, sending it here instead of there, how is that lighting a fire? Who's this?
It's Dennis Leary.
Funny?
Yeah, not like Uncle Mitch.
He was funny. Get your shit, Maggie. We're leaving.
Good. Get out.
This is my property. You're my tenant. You have 48 hours to pack.
Sit down, Robert, please. Eat.
Fuck eating! All you ever want me to do is eat. I'm not your child. Shut your mouth. No eating, no drinking, no talking. Nothing. Check it.
Who are you? I don't know you. I don't know you.
I'll be back in 48 hours with your team. You think about where you want to go. Zaki, kiddo, I love you. Delphine, peace.
Sans plus attendre, permettez-moi de vous présenter le cinématographe Lumière.
Maybe now you're a gypsy.
Darling, come join.
I can see it! I can see it!
It's quite a catch.
It's fun to see that once in a while.
How many of you are planning to do your demo reel this summer? Okay, Ronald, any advice?
It's very tough. It's very tough. You have to have somebody else there tell you what to take out because you want to keep it in, all that. I mean, this is like 20 years of my life in 5 minutes. I have a friend who's an editor in New York with whom I work. I take advice from my friends, of my wife, or a couple of, I mean, not even, but my agents actually also put in the 3 cents. They say, oh, that's a good, you must have a scene from this, because you also want to have the most recent work at the beginning. You want to have the work that represents you the best. You know, I mean, it's not like you guys are young, you don't have that, but you should show a scene that's actually a scene that is consistent, not just chop, 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 like I do at the end. At the end, I go chop, 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 because it's like old movies. But at the beginning, I have a long excerpt of Mildred Pierce. I have a longer excerpt from Mad Men, because those are recent big HBO whatever shows. So I want them to, you know what I mean? So you can actually see some acting. So if you direct a scene and you don't have that much to show, Anyway, you should take, you know, the best scene out of your shorts.
13.
Yeah.
I just realized that was you from 13.
That's right.
That was straight to DVD. A lot of people did not really familiar with it.
Absolutely.
Was that an independent?
I'm glad you asked the question because I was very fond of that movie. It was a French Georgian director who made a film in France for $300,000. It was a black and white movie. It played at Film Forum. It won a prize in Cannes. It was exactly the same story with French actors. It was weird. It was in black and white. It was the strangest thing about Russian roulette. Very dark, very Georgia, Russia, not Georgia, USA. And so some producers saw it and bought the rights of a remake. And they hired Mickey Rourke and 50 Cent and Jason Statham and Ronald Gutman and Alexander Skarsgård. And we did a remake for $15 million and it was a total flop. Because the director came and insisted on doing exactly the same movie he had done in France. The shots, the frame, the style, the actors have to stand like this, turn your face a little like that. He framed it like a sculptor, like a painter, and American actors are not used to this. American actors need freedom, some sort of within the framework and the boundaries that you give them, American actors are used to a certain amount of freedom. Don't tell me to put my hand over here in the scene when I feel like doing this to you. I don't have to do this to you. But he insisted on framing it and recapturing the original film. And they didn't get along, producers and director. He was he wasn't flexible enough. One of the most important things in your medium, this is a good question you ask, is how important it is to be flexible in working with producers and actors. Sometimes you find yourself in front of a big movie star who doesn't necessarily respect you or know what you are. And I remember doing The Hunt for Red October with Sean Connery. I mean, he had more power on the set than John McTiernan, meaning like the director was a little afraid of Sean Connery, and Sean Connery would sometimes tell him what to do or not to do. There is a measure. You have to be able to have authority over your actors, of course, but you also have to know how to be flexible, especially with the producers, who are in the end telling you, man, we only have another week to finish this, or you have to have this done by 11, or you must hire this, or do that, or it's not that important if, you know, and you go like, no, this is absolutely, it's not the Bible, you know, let's bring it down to size here. It's just making movies entertainment. Very important to be honest and truthful, and some directors get more control than others and produce their own work, and when you have earned that, then you can do maybe more things your way. But very often, especially in television, you are dependent on the producers who run the show. You just have to deliver them with a finished product that is... I've worked on the film that the guy was fired after 2 days. It was my first job with Michael Keaton, Skip Tracer. We shot this on the Intrepid. It was after I met you. And the guy was an English director, terrific guy, but he didn't know how to shoot American style, meaning he didn't do coverage, which is, you know, there's too much. Woody Allen doesn't care. Woody Allen shoots you like this. He doesn't go in close-ups and coverage you. He's happy with like a theater. He shoots you in the frame because that's Woody Allen. He controls his own production. He's an auteur. He has proven. He puts his own money in his films. Nobody can tell him what to do. That's the exception that confirms the rules. Most of the time, directors have to absolutely cover. And you know, in television, sometimes it's mind-boggling. You do the same scene over and over and over for each actor who has to have its close-up, and you have to find ways to make it interesting. And
that's what we talked about earlier. I mean, mm-hmm. We've been meeting television and film directors this semester. Ronald will work on a series as the actor, and have two or three different directors for the same series. Could you talk a little about, you know, the showrunner? I know you just mentioned a little bit about it.
Yeah, of course. Mm-hmm. Like I said, the television is in the hand of the man who had the vision of the pilot. And from there on, he hires different writers. Each writer works for a character. Some writers follow this, like, let's say Mad Men. Who's familiar with Mad Men? Anybody watches Mad Men? Okay, great. So some guys are following Don Draper. Somebody is George Sterling. Some writers, and when I did my first reading at a table, there were like 45 people around this table, and everybody was a producer-writer. And then the director was the fellow who came and just implemented the vision that had been written by the writers and the producer, Matthew Weiner. Television is really a producer's medium, and the writers who have the idea become the producers. So it's controlled by the writer-producer. He doesn't direct. He's a writer who has the idea of creating Don Draper and Company. That's where the genius is. Then he becomes the producer because he sold the idea to the studio. And then he hires directors. And he tells the directors, this is what's important. Her hair has to be like this every episode. And to every director, he's going to say, we must keep the style. And of course, directors have to be able to direct actors and how to place camera. And it's a whole other ball of wax. And that's what some of you are studying here. The technique of directing, which is a fundamental language. If you do your own script and you write your own way and you want to be more independent and more free, then you can do whatever you want. You can shoot like this and like this and like that and like that. But not if you're doing Mad Men or Good Wife or Sopranos. Then you have to fit the vision of David Chase. And David Chase has, you know, I just read, Sidney Lumet. Yeah, he said that Prince of the City. He said it was all about the sky, could never see the sky, because sky represented freedom. So all the characters have to be framed within or inside. The only moment when the character comes out of the subway is because he thinks he's going to commit suicide, and that's freedom. So you see the sky. I'm just saying that's an interesting vision.
I just want to add, this weekend I heard David Isley, who shoots Blue Bloods. Anyone watch that? It's on Friday night with Tom Selleck. He's about a police commission. Every scene, every Friday night, there's a scene where he has Sunday lunch with his family in this beautiful brownstone. And it looks beautiful, warm, everyone's red. And I asked the cinematographer, is that the way you want it? He said, no, Tom likes it that way. Tom, it's called Tom's Light. It has to look like the way Tom wants his Sunday afternoon.
Of course.
So we have 10 different directors, and they all have to make Sunday dinner look like Tom's life. But it's interesting. The actors will tell you how it should look. Barbara Streisand.
Well, he's a producer of the show. Some stars become the producers of the show, and therefore they have the same power, but much more power than the director.
Much more
power. On television, in those kinds of shows.
Which brings us to the next question. Ronald and I were talking about your first films before we start looking at them, because I know you want to start looking at them.
Mm-hmm.
So the last question before we open it up and start looking at your films, who worked with professional actors this year on their films? They're still working with professional, okay. The big question is, have you ever worked with professional actors before?
Before
before this film, yes. No. Okay. Ronald, any advice to the students who haven't yet worked with professional actors, or even the ones that did, on what they got to look forward to instead of casting their brother and sister and neighbor down the hallway? Anything different than the neighbor down the hallway?
No, I think that I've seen some fantastic movies with non-professional actors, only because the directors knew what to say and how to draw performances.
Like when we met.
Well, I was a professional actor when you met me, because I had done already 10 years of theater. The credits, I'm a trained theater actor, so that's what I do since the age of 17. I did all kinds of classic plays before doing any television. I didn't care about movie or television. I was just immersed in the classics. So, and I went to conservatory, and I went to many places to study acting. But that doesn't necessarily make me a better film actor than the guy that you would pick up on Jerome and Broadway there.
Jerome Burnside.
And take a camera with him. I mean, he can't do what I do. He can't play Shakespeare, maybe. But maybe I can't do what he can do, which is that to be totally in his character, if it's about a guy who knows this area, who lives in this area, and who you're going to follow with the camera. Now, there's a fine line between documentary and fiction. But many people are able to take actors for who they are, and especially in film, even if that's very limited, it's good enough for the role that you need. So you don't always have to think, I need professional actors and taken by that. You must have the best person for the job that you're writing, for the character that you have. If you find a great actor that can play, that's great. And then you have to know how to have a dialogue with an actor. You don't direct that. You have to know, if you can speak to an amateur and say to the amateur, listen, I want you right now to don't speak so loud. Look in this direction and think of your mother and remember what happened to you when you were a teenager, when you came home and she gave you a sandwich, and show me the love in your eyes for your mother. You can say that to an amateur, and you can say this to a professional. There's no difference. If the kid that you picked up on Jerome is capable of giving you that emotion, you directed him well. If you take Willem Dafoe or anybody as an actor and you say, or you tell him, you're still stuck in the old, you have to tell him exactly the same thing. And he has to deliver the goods. And if he doesn't, you have to tell him. It's not exactly what I want. Don't bring it down a little bit. Or I didn't feel it. Or, and of course, with actors, what's most important thing is for them to experience what you tell them, so that the audience can feel it. So you see immediately if the person you're directing is sincere. Film medium is about honesty, sincerity. It's about the truth. Just like in life, you're there with your girlfriend, you say, I love you, and you don't feel it, she's not going to believe you, she's not going to buy it. It's the same thing in the arts. Don't bullshit me, don't lie to me. This is what you have to tell an actor, don't bullshit me. You're acting. Nothing is worse than to see somebody acting. Because everybody in the audience is going to go, I'm not buying this. You don't want to see acting. Great actors don't act, they react to what's going on around them. You have to put them in the context. That's why I was saying, if you have reality TV, why is reality TV so strong now? Because people think on TV they're better actors than actors. Why? Because they are who they are. They can't do anything else than to be the Contessa or Housewives of New York. That's who they are. But I'm just saying, people are fascinated by truth. They want to see truth. Very often with actors, you have no truth. It's make-believe. People have very little tolerance for make-believe now because of documentaries, because of reality TV. Because of the new CNN and SNBC, we see people there. You want to play a terrorist? You want to play a passionate revolutionary in your movie? And I watch Channel 14 and I see what it's like in Pakistan. Or in the middle, I see what it's really like. And you give me this bullshit performance? I don't buy your movie. I'm not going to go see it. Give me the real thing. Find the, make, put the actor in the situation that he will be that way. And do whatever you have to do to make him become this enraged, mad revolutionary. But you have to find a way to do it. If he pretends that he is like that, and you don't believe him, cut him off right away.
Who's going to show their first scene? Sebastian? Okay, Sebastian, while we're setting up, could someone set up, could you tell Ronald your tagline and your synopsis? Oh, by the way, do not leave this class today until Sebastian has your tagline and synopsis or no movie poster. Movie posters are being made next week. We don't have that, no movie poster.
You want to turn around?
No.
Yeah, I've got to go see it. Yeah.
And you'll tell
I'd rather
us
see it. Don't tell me what it's about.
Okay.
I'd rather see it.
Yeah.
Is there sound?
Yeah, well, the effects are not in, just the voices for the main character.
Okay, right now, no music.
No music, no sound effects. Could you
Agent
move, could you
X.
Move the controls, please?
You will be inserted into the offices of Hanson Wazotsky, the financial services firm.
This is what I can call my idea. You have one of the things that does make out of the whole experience. Αναμένουμε θα είναι αναπτύξει μόνο στο τουρκικό Υπουργείο Ανακοινώσεων στην κατοχή των δαπανοσύνων με τον Ελλάδα. Φυσικά. Ευχαριστώ.
Her name, we believe, is Giselle Taylor. We do know her bodyguard, and if she needs him, then you will be able to handle this with ease. Your objectives are these. All of the data relating to the Arcturus HD 85512 Bravo. It will look like a simple system failure until the backup fails to restore. Once this occurs, the QRF will be dispatched. Your service provider will be monitoring from a ghost link to prevent fail-safe assets from inhibiting the propagation of the hack. Your final objective will be the prototype for the Arcturus HD 85512. 2, Bravo, you will need to procure it from the target and secure it. Based on the current skill level of her bodyguard, it should take you approximately 17 seconds to pacify him and secure the prototype.
I can stop you.
That's it. That's how you end? I mean, that's the way you want to end?
No, that's the middle. There are several effects that have to go into some of the frames that you did see, and they help illustrate what's actually occurring.
You're like three into your 5 minutes. This is sort of an assembly rough cut.
I'm sorry.
They have 3 weeks to finish their 5 minute film, so they're still shooting. You're like at the perfect time.
Okay. Well, I will not take it upon myself to, because it's a very personal, obviously you have a very personal style. I like very much, it's intriguing. I don't know what I'm seeing. I like the way you play with the bzz, 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 the artificial intelligence, bzz, bzz, Mission Impossible technology. I kind of find that intriguing and actually not very common to see this. It's a Matrix-like. I like this, it's kind of, very well lit. Is there something of the characters? I don't understand. I think you try to make a parody of something with all this lingo. I don't think this is meant to be understood or clear. I think it's a complete absurd piece. It is absurd, but you have to be careful that the absurdity is not too obvious and too. I mean, it's funny almost. It's very hard to. I think some of the frames, the frame on the profile, it's some of it is very well done, very framed. The international conspiracy, the Greek guy, the thing. It probably makes no sense at all, which is fun. I mean, but I would say that in order to succeed doing something like this, you still have to have a unifying, you know, factor. The sum has to be superior to the total has to be superior to the sum of its parts. You have to have some an overview of the whole thing, which still leads us to something.
Which is why I stopped it right here.
Because you have two different sets and two different colors, and two different people, and it's important to have at least a thread of identification. Because if I'm completely like, it's a spoof, I'm going to lose my interest. If you intrigue me enough so that little by little I realize that you're making fun of me, then I get it. But here I have the feeling that from the very beginning, at the beginning I really thought you did, but after, let's say, a minute, it wasn't very clear. But you don't put any music, because the music is a big part of this. I don't know if you're planning on doing something. You should have sound. I don't say music, but sound. I think it's a movie that asks for sound because there's such little dialogue, and it's such a mysterious. So you want to help me get in the mood.
So let me just segue.
It's very original.
You know, Ronald's the president of Highbrow Entertainment and gets involved, in the development of the critical stages of a filmmaker's project. If he came to you with this project, I mean, this is just a perfect example. Mm-hmm. When would someone like him come in an assembly, in a rough cut, in a fine? I mean, if he needed another $100,000 to complete this, which you don't, correct?
No.
Good. I mean, when do you tell a filmmaker come back and see me in a year?
I mean, first of all, don't run this kind of company. I work on scripts. We get scripts. This is not about the script. If he were to bring me a script of a film, and I would read the script and like it, I would ask, have you done anything else? He would say, yes. I would say, show me what you've done in the past. He would show me. This would not be enough right now for me to know anything about, but I would see that he's original. I would see that he has a vision, that he's got something that he's not at all coming from I watch TV and I'm making TV films. He's obviously someone who has an originality. So I would, if I had a good script and an original filmmaker, however flawed the film may be, I would already have 2 out of 3 important things: a great script, an original filmmaker with personality. Then we would start a conversation.
Very good. So these are great tips for you, Sebastian.
Yeah, definitely.
Round of applause for Sebastian. Okay. He's going to show us the next piece. Volunteer? Yes. James. This is James Creakey, our chief engineer.
Yes.
Again, this is just my personal observation.
Yes.
He's talking about the various items, and all of them have code numbers and code names.
Yes.
Is it just me, or do the numbers and the names seem too long?
He's in his assembly rough cut. So, what type of feedback
like
have you been getting?
Much of a model number, a shorter name code would have been.
Yeah.
He's absolutely right. That's what I said about you making too much of your parody.
Yeah.
He's saying it technically you're wrong, and you should be based on you're talking about coding and programming.
Like, for example, if he's talking about this item, it has a model number. If the model number has too many digits, it's distracting.
That's very good. It has to be plausible, even though it's absurd.
Well, that's the catch, isn't it? This agency has been working for such a long time, which is something that you're gonna see right after this scene, which is why I cut right here. they've been doing this for such a long time that you can't even you would not even be able to follow. You know, that's for the extreme.
What kind of agency are they?
They are a clandestine, agency. They use non-lethal methods to disarm dangerous arms.
So when the girl on the phone gets the bodyguard to attack, she's the head of the agency. By the way, I like the fact you go back, Bing. You go back and back, and then you do something from the side. I thought that this scene you could. I mean, even with the camera, you can even create more maybe mystery or something. I mean, it's not already. I love the POV like this, and the cast is great, and the thing, the Mission Impossible thing, is amazing. Actually, that you did very well. Your special effects are amazing.
And you're doing it all.
Yes.
Editing, special effects, writing, directing, excellent. If we don't have another clip to show, we're going to talk a little bit about. We do have another clip. Okay, can we boot it up? No, go boot it up. Thank you.
And anyway, you're on the right track. You're trying to do something very personal.
Now, Edgar is going to boot up his own clip, and
we're
going to get into position.
Go!
So what's the story with you? Did you really think I would have noticed the guy with the big ass lens pointing at my boobs?
Wait, I wasn't even front right here. Huh. So, you work in the power place?
Yep. And you're a photographer?
Yes.
And does my stalker have a name?
Yes, I am. I'm not a stalker.
I'm Sarah.
Hey, let's come a little closer so we can speak to you. Come. Take the hot seat.
Hot seat?
Yeah, right here. It's hot over here. It's nice and hot. Face the chair towards us. Comments? Suggestions for your classmate? This is the time. He's in his assembly rough cut.
Sure.
I'm grading those rough cuts next Wednesday.
It's difficult to understand when you don't have the narration.
Of course. But you've walked us through this. You haven't told, well...
Yeah.
I need help because I'm a bit lost.
Go ahead. You're on.
This guy have a very bad insomnia and he doesn't remember when was the last time he slept. So he decided that the only way that he can sleep is by killing himself. So he will do it and didn't help him at all. So in the middle of everything, he was in love with this woman and they meet each other and they have a good time. He was happy, but which I never show it. But in the end, when he finally have the opportunity to sleep again and sleep one more time, he never wakes. So that's the ending, which I didn't include it, but that's what happened in this movie. So it was one of the points. Yeah, it looks sticking, right?
So the first guy in the kitchen, the harakiri, it's him. Then he sees himself the double, yeah?
Once again, he killed himself a couple of times, but it didn't work.
My favorite shot in the film is when you face the wall with the two windows, because I expect him to just...
He's going down, but I don't have any movie, right? That
was kind of, wow. That had a lot of tension, because there was nothing going on. To tell you the truth, I'm not a dramaturg, script writer, teacher, so I would never take it upon myself to give you advice. I just couldn't understand. I think you have a good presence as an actor. You carry. I never felt that you were suffering, that you didn't have insomnia, that you were unhappy, that you were... I thought you were like a nice guy walking around the Bronx with smoking a cigarette, which you don't do very well. and that you were looking for something, and then I started thinking about the double, the idea of this and that, but I never felt this, what you're saying, it's about a guy who needs to find a solution to a problem, which is what you're describing now, a guy who can't, insomnia is a disease, it's a very, very bad disease, it's a horrible thing, it makes you, you're taking, you know, whatever, it's a... It's a condition. I didn't feel that, like I was saying before, so I couldn't understand the story because you as the character and also as the way you wrote the story did not convey any pain or any disturbance or any problem. You were just happy to go into your kitchen, open the fridge, have a piece of toast, a slice of tomato, whatever. You seem to be a good guy walking around. So I didn't know that you had a problem.
Yeah, it's very difficult to convince using 5 minutes because my original script was 15. So I tried to do the translation, mm-hmm. the transitions about what is happening in the boys. I'm trying to cover everything by boys. Since it's not relative, it's birds. Imagine watching Discovery Channel without sound. You don't know what is happening. You just see animals, and that's it. But that's one of the points.
Yeah, no, I understand. I just don't understand what the tension is, the drama. I mean, I guess a script, as you all know, has to have some kind of conflict, tension, progression, arc, evolution, like in life. We start this, we do this, we have obstacles, and we say we try to go around it, and then we get what we want. What do you want? It's every actor and every filmmaker has to ask himself the question, what do I want? What is my character want? You know, what does your character want? You, I mean, in your movie, I can somehow feel that there is some sort of conspiracy. This girl on the chair, she wants to control something with the Greek guy. Is that her partner? So they're working on towards money, politics, CIA, I don't give a shit. They want something. There's some sort of wanting. You know what I'm saying? So I can somehow go like, okay, what's gonna happen? With you, I didn't know what you wanted. What was the, like in life, I want to succeed, I want to work, I want to kill myself, I want to fuck, I don't know what. You know, what do you want? Characters have to want something. What do you need?
Sleep.
Well, I did feel it. and it's a very difficult thing to convey. Wanting to sleep. I think you would ask a director. I mean, of course, you would have then a script of somebody who is, you know, you see him. I mean, I guess the moment where you're lying down and you get up like this is like a fraction of a second. If you think that that's enough to convey to me that you want sleep, it's not. It's not at all. If you are a character who can't sleep and smokes because that's the way he keeps himself up and drinks coffee or nicotine is what he's addicted to, you know, then I'd show me that. Make me feel for you. You're a guy in need of something.
Actually, I cut a lot of part of the script because my original one was 15 to 20 minutes. So I have pills and I have all this complicating stuff.
Anyway, I've said more than I should. I think it's very important in life to write about people who need and who want something. And everything in your movie is going to prevent them to get there, or it's going to be an obstacle, or it's going to be easy, or you think it's going to be drama. You have to go back to the essentials of dramatic structure, and you know, for that you have to read Robert McKee. I don't know what you learn here in terms of screenwriting. You must have read some books about screen, you know, drama.
Actually, next year.
Don't they have a classes?
Yeah, we have our first screenwriting development class in our new curriculum. Right now, they've been.
But in media studies, they don't study Robert McKee, story structure, Casablanca.
No, not in media.
So nobody's given you the Act 1, Act 2, Act 3 commandments and all that stuff? You just take a camera and shoot.
Many of them are certified public access producers at BronxNet, and I know you go through production.
Yeah, but let's say you're a public access producer on that. You make a documentary. You make a movie about anything. You have to have a storyline, right?
Yeah. I studied screenwriting before I came here.
Before you came here?
Yeah, it's not here.
Who's going to show the next piece? Do we have anyone else? So I want to just do a segue here. Does anyone have any questions for Ronald before we continue? Because he has quite a resume as an actor, as a producer. He's worked in theater, in film, in television. Yes, Leroy.
Back to that movie 13. I thought that was a really good movie. What was the name of the original?
Tsunami 13. It's in Georgian. I think it was Tsunami, Stsemani. You go to Gela Babluani, that's the name of the director. Tsunami, not Tsunami, but Babluani. Just go online to Google Gela, G-E-L-A, and then Babluani, B-A-B-L-U-A-N-I, okay? Babluani. You see it? And you go Gela Babluani, Tsunami 13, which means in Georgian number 13.
Right.
Ronald, you've worked with a lot of young filmmakers, and many of the filmmakers went to film school. Some of them didn't. Many of the students you're talking to today will be going to a 4-year film school. How important is it
for a young filmmaker to leave here with an associate's degree mm-hmm. at a community college to go on to continue their studies, or should they just go into the film industry? Big question they always ask.
No, you have to go. You have to go and really go into more advanced studies and work in dramatic and from every single point of view. I'm not saying you can't work and do stuff and continue what you're doing and experimenting, and but you have to. There's such a competitive business. Film has become the medium of your generation. Everybody has an iPhone. Everybody can make movies. A lot of people have ideas, a lot of people have visions. A lot of people have access. There was a time when we were 20 years old where to make a movie you have to go and rent a Super 16 camera, a Super 8, you have to go to the store and rent. Now everybody is a filmmaker.
Everybody.
So it means that you have to be even more knowledgeable and talented, whatever you want to call it, or have ideas or script or stories, because you're going to compete against tremendous amount of people your age and your generation from all over the world who are trying to do a similar thing, which is to direct the next episode of Sopranos, or to make a movie with George Clooney, or to make the great commercials for $3 million that last 30 seconds on CBS, or to be a documentary filmmaker that will be produced by PBS, or to be the next filmmaker that's going to make a small film that will be noticed at a film festival. Even if there's no money attached. No matter what, in order to be noticed, in order to do anything, you must go on. And there are so many interesting schools in this country, so many fabulous colleges and film schools all around the country. It doesn't have to be New York, God knows, that you have to find a way to get there.
Introduce your first last name.
My name is Jennifer Medina. My question is, in your professional career, do you have a specific or liking that you choose, like acting, producing, and theater work? What is your favorite, or is it all your passion?
It's all part of a journey.
It's all.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. I'd like to ask this question. What are you reading currently?
Excuse me?
What are you reading currently?
What am I reading currently? I'm reading the book that the play I'm doing this summer is based upon, so I have to reread it. The Master and Margarita by Michael Bulgakov. It's a classic and I have to reread it. Actually, in the train today I was reading it. We have to always read many different things. I read a lot of scripts. I have auditions. I read play and movie scripts for my auditions. I have to, I read a lot of magazines, newspapers. I'm very into politics. I'm very informed. I try to keep informed. The op-ed page of the New York Times. I spend a bit too much time reading the New York Times. I also read foreign publications. I'm a political animal. So I love to read commentary, analysis. I wish I could read more novels, but in order to get into a novel, you have to sort of and lose yourself in the novel. I wish I could do that, but I'm not very good at it. I read shorter things. And I'm reading Salvador Dali's biography, The Diary of a Madman or of a Genius. I don't remember which one.
Did you see Mumet's book?
No. That was just a caption in the magazine this week. Okay. No, I have two or three books. I did a lot of Jewish studies because I love to go to I love the tradition of Jewish mystical tradition and interpretation of the Bible. So I read a lot of stuff. I take classes that deal with that stuff because I want to understand a little bit better where is it that this tradition comes from.
How important is it, Ronald, for our students to not only see contemporary American films, but to hang out at the Film Forum, to go to the Angelica Cinema? Because a lot of our students are watching films that I feel they can wait until they're on TV. Could you talk a little bit about that? Because you see a lot of movies.
That's a conversation I have with my kids, who are 22 and 20, and who go to college, NYU Science and Hampshire College, Massachusetts, and who are studying very terrific stuff. They're both in science. But it's true that American kids are a little limited in their choices coming from growing in front of American television box, and they're very much influenced by what they see, and they have very little knowledge of foreign languages, which none of them hardly speaks, or foreign culture. It is possible now on Hulu or on Netflix to access some foreign films. There are lots of ways to do so. On demand, it's very, very thin. When I go on demand, channeled 1000 in my Time Warner, and I try to download some films by Fellini, Buñuel, Bergman, all the classics I grew up with, or others, I'm very frustrated. I don't see much stuff coming my way, and this is the biggest American corporation. If I go IFC on demand, I have a bigger choice. IFC is a great channel. It has a nice variety of films on demand, European films. Not everybody can go to West 4th Street and 6th Avenue at the IFC Center. I mean, I don't know the situation in the Bronx. I would gather that you don't have an art house here, do you?
Do we have an art house in the Bronx? Bronx Community College, Media Tech Club meeting, 12 to 2.
Right, but there is no demand, unfortunately, and it's too bad. One has to do with subtitles. A lot of people don't like to read subtitles. And so that already eliminates a lot of things. I would check a lot of Hispanics people in this college. I would check the greatest directors working today are Mexican. The three greatest directors that work in Hollywood are all from Mexico.
New York Film Festival's coming up. You have the American Independent Feature Market. There are many opportunities to see films in New York. Any other questions for our guest? Okay, we'll do Sebastian and then Edgar.
Okay. I know you're inundated by all this stuff, scripts and so on, but do you have a chance to ever watch television? And if you do, like, what is it that you find? I should qualify that. Fictional.
Okay, not the news. Back to Rachel Maddow's. Or rather, soccer. Sunday morning. Chelsea Everton. It's my favorite. I am watching through my kids. I've learned a lot about TV. Okay, my kids have grown up in America, so I've watched a lot of, great cartoons. I love cartoons. I love Cars. I love American Dad. I love Family Guy. I appreciate the work that goes behind the subversive, the politics that is in the cartoon. Cartoons are very smart vehicles to convey subversive political messages, which people and kids really get, and they become cooler than cool. Then there are the greatest series, of course, that everybody gets hooked on, and I don't watch it religiously, but God knows that The Sopranos or The Wire or The Mad Men or this or that. I mean, I don't watch the Game of Thrones. I can't get into it, but many people I respect are completely taken by it. The most incredible psychiatrist person I know in New York is a fan of this. I think that people who deal with violent cases, in psychology, they need to watch TV that is violent because it reminds them of the violence of their practice in life. I think violence is such an American thing in society that people need to watch it, to understand it, to transcend it, to feel, it's not that bad, actually. After seeing Game of Thrones, you walk in the downtown Bronx, you piece of cake, You don't have to worry about anything. But, I mean, there are a lot of other, and girly stuff with my daughter. I have to say that I love the Broadway stuff, like Glee, Smash, with the talent of singing. I mean, there's so much to choose from. Like I was telling Jeffrey, the greatest theater writers in New York, my friend Jeffrey knows me, he went to do Brothers and Sisters. I never watched a show, but I mean, he's like Broadway caliber, Theresa Rebeck, playwrights. What do they do? They move to Hollywood to become series writers because they make money, of course, but also because they're challenged to write drama that's every week has to evolve and has to surprise millions of people. It's very challenging, very hard to television is an amazing medium because it can educate and at the same time entertain and at the same time make you cry. I mean, and that you have to study. You have to know.
Edgar.
Yes. Here's one question. Why are you an actor or not a doctor or a physicist or a cowboy or something like that?
Why am I what? I didn't understand.
An actor and not another
a physicist?
Career. What is this?
Or a cowboy.
Oh, you mean what made me an actor? It's a good question. You start when you're young, you do something. Either get the girl at the school, please your parents, or do the opposite of what your parents want to do. I mean, you're around 14, 15, 16, 17 years old, I started acting while I was in school. I was good at it, or people noticed me because I had a certain presence, or my looks, or my voice. And so I got, and everybody likes to go like, you know, tap on the shoulder, so your ego gets flattered, which is never a good reason to do anything. But still, it's encouraging along the way. And then I went through law school, but at the same time I became a professional actor. I did a lot of theater in Belgium at the time, but I wanted, for my father was insisting kind of that I also had a diploma to show him that I could do both things at the same time. So I pursued, but I knew I would never do law, but I liked the fact that law was kind of similar to acting because it's about convincing people. It's about being the lawyer of your character. What an actor has to do is to be the lawyer of his character. If you ask me to play the worst character in the world, I would still have to find in me the justification of my character, okay? If I have to be the guy who bombs the World Trade Center, I have to find in me the reasons why I want to do it. So I have to become the best lawyer of this guy that I read about on the stage, okay? That's the job of an actor. So when you work with actors, always find out, are they good lawyers for their character? Are they making the case? Because very often actors will take on the character and not like the character and pretend they play it, but they're not really the character because they don't become the lawyer of their character. They just, you know, like, I would never be that guy. But that's not what you want to do as an actor. So I did study law. I could have gone that way, but I always felt that being an actor was a better way to do what I like rather than being a rabbi or a lawyer. Because I could have been a rabbi and convinced people of what I want to tell them. Because, look, this is like a church right here, right now, right? When I'm an actor, you're in front of a church. The lights go down, it's 8 o'clock, 800 people in the room. It's like being in the church. And the actors in front of you, instead of saying the word of Jesus, etc., are telling you the words of Shakespeare, which are much more disturbing. And they get it under your skin, and it's for the audience to go through the different characters of King Lear and his three daughters to make his own, the people in the audience make their own church. But many people who go come to our profession, especially in the theater, come from the same desire to bring community together. It's community. Theater is a community, just like a church, where people are experiencing something outside of themselves, and 2 hours later they have to be transformed. They have to leave the theater and go like, whew, I just forgot everything about that. Maybe I never thought I would feel that. I never seen a family like this. That reminds me of my family. My family is just like this. This was, maybe I'll learn something. Maybe I'll be different with my son tonight. I'll speak differently, whatever. That's what you get from a great.
I just want to interrupt. This summer I took my family to see Ashalev on Broadway. And when I walked out, I didn't realize Ron was the producer. And I looked in the program and I said, I know, this is Ronald. And when I looked at the project, with the play, I said to myself, this is something Ronald would produce. Because when you walk out of that theater, just like Ronald said, I wanted to become a better father, a better listener, especially a father of the Jewish faith. This, if you haven't seen the play, the boy is a painter, but he's painting Jesus on the cross. You know, so it reminds
me. And his father's a rabbi.
His father's a rabbi. So
it's not easy. His father is against what he wants to do. Exactly. It's about, you know, how Lady Gaga sings. You know, what's the song of Lady Gaga? I Am What I Am, or what's the song? Let Me Be Who I Am, or what's the famous Lady Gaga song? Whatever.
So one of the things.
Whatever.
One of the things that we talk about.
Like, you guys, you know the fucking Lady Gaga. Let me call my daughter.
One of the things we talk about in this class is that the first film that they're making this year will probably be some of the themes and metaphors will be the exact same film that they'll be making for years to come. Could you talk about that a little bit? Because you've worked with some filmmakers again and again. Do you see them making, or there's things in their films that are the same themes and metaphors that they're always talking about? Or do they really, you know, switch gears and make a film that's completely different?
Yeah, I'm not sure I would agree with you there, Jeffrey. I think that it's important, the first two movies that you do, then usually the second one is quite different. The third one, the first movie is a reflection, like him starring in his own movie. So there's obviously something there that he wants to say that's very close to him right now. And maybe it is insomnia, which is a great subject, by the way. It's a very interesting idea of desperation about insomnia. It's very original. But I'm just saying that could be the first film you make. But it's not always going to be, I don't think so. I mean, of course, if you are a great filmmaker, you look back and you say, are there common themes in all the films of Martin Scorsese? I guess, you could say that it's about gangsters in New York and Brooklyn, blah, blah, blah. I guess you could say that. Is it the same for Sidney Lumet? I guess you work in a milieu. You're right, as a filmmaker, you know a certain milieu, a certain community that you can't tell stories. Sidney Lumet can't make a movie about French comedy. He doesn't know much about, maybe the mechanism of French comedy, whatever that means. But I'm sure that's a good question. But what do you think? You don't think that,
Well, let me just break.
Look at Steve Soderbergh. I mean, he's made Ocean 11. He's done this. He's done that. I mean, this guy keeps going from here to there.
No, I think that's wonderful. And I think one of the things I wanted to get across is this is our 20th annual film festival, and for 10 years, students were allowed to. It was an open reign. Whatever they wanted to bring to the screen, that's what they brought to the screen. Unfortunately, every film had a gun in it. So 10 years ago. One of the prerequisites was on your first draft of your 5-minute screenplay, no guns. So we took out the guns, and obviously you only got to see a little bit of what this festival's about, but there are no guns.
There's a knife, and there is, in his movie, there is not a gun, but something.
We actually had people's heads being blown off. We took that out. I mean, I was talking the other day to one of our students.
But why are you making a moral, taking a moral standpoint here?
Do you think the students in this class should be making films about what they see in their own neighborhood and about their own lives, or should they be taking a stab at making films about things that they don't know about?
If you ask me?
Yes.
The first scenario. My answer to your question would be they should make movies about what they know.
Okay.
Like this gentleman wants to produce documentaries about his community.
Ramik.
With the taking out of guns, I always thought that people just find a new weapon to put in. Like, I end up using a screwdriver.
I have several.
Now, by the way, you can make your movie about the two. What you're saying is not contradictory.
Yeah.
Take the gun is a fun exercise, but they could still make the movie about their neighborhood.
Right.
You're
absolutely
not telling them not to write a movie about what they know.
Right.
Is what they know here about guns? Is this what it's about? It's about violence,
right,
or neighborhood. I don't know, or poverty, or alienation, or drugs, or addiction. Make a movie about addiction. You don't need a gun. I mean, I'm just saying, it's not about the gun. It's about the situation.
No, I was just saying that. I have several guns in my film, but you don't see any of them. So you'll hear
I just thought this was an interesting part of the conversation, because Ronald is very politically and involved in, and I don't know if his readings, but in his discussion, and I just thought we would talk about that here. The documentary filmmaker, the only documentary film, and then we're going to close with that. Keanu, just tell Ronald what your movie's about. I want him to give you some feedback. Nice and loud.
I'm doing a documentary about this controversy between light-skinned people and dark-skinned people.
About what I'm getting here.
Light-skinned people and dark-skinned people. Like, you see it every day and everywhere in my community, where I grow up, everything, like.
You say icing people?
Do you have your clip with you? Do you have it?
Maybe I don't understand the accent. What are you saying? So I didn't translate for me.
Come close. Oh, she's going to take the seat.
Okay.
She's doing this.
Maybe it's the word, I don't know. Remember, I'm not American.
Director's chair.
I'm just
Do we have your clip? No, we don't have it.
It should
good. We'll boot it up. It's only 2 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Tell Ronald what he's going to see.
It's about light-skinned people and dark-skinned people.
Say that again.
Light-skinned and
dark-skinned. Light-skinned and dark-skinned. You don't say white or black. See, light or dark.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. Okay.
And basically how it's affecting everyone and children, you know, basically that.
Let's watch the clip,
great.
Talk.
And
that
then sounds like a
we're going to have a
universal theme.
I've never had, you know, a complex or felt like I was inferior because of me being a woman of color, you know. I feel a certain empowerment. And, you know, the blacker the berry, the sweeter the juice. I feel like light-skinned people always get the upper hand in everything, whether it's with jobs, being like just relationships, everything.
I remember doing a study of blacks and whites in prison. And it was clear that there are more blacks in prison than whites. And after getting out of prison, the whites were easily employed compared to blacks with criminal records.
There's no legit reason why we should be looked at or looked down on because of our complexion.
I have a little sister. She had the dread. But whenever she goes to school, she would come back and say, when I went to school, my friends were giving me a whole lot of names. And my mom told her, never be confused or never be like disturbed when people tell you that you don't look beautiful. I gave birth to you and I know you look beautiful.
People that I know, they see me, oh, you're really pretty. And oh, you're pretty for a dark-skinned girl. So like as a dark-skinned girl, am I supposed to be ugly? Like, I don't understand. I don't get why that phrase is used so much, as if you're dark skin or you have darker skin, you're just automatically supposed to be ugly, and if you have light skin, you're supposed to be so beautiful.
There was a time where I was dating a dark-skinned girl, and you know, my friends were like, yo, she is black. She is really dark. And at the time, I didn't find anything wrong with it. I still don't, you know. A person is a person.
I think in society and media, having a darker complexion is definitely not idolized as much as it is having a lighter complexion. The environment, what you see on TV and movies, there's always this very specific image of what's considered good or perfect or acceptable. And when you teach kids that there's only this one thing that they should strive for and strive to be or look like, they kind of grow up not appreciating who they are for themselves. And they kind of think that they're doing something wrong or that maybe there's something wrong with them because of the images they see and want to be like. And usually, the darker complexion isn't that image that's being idolized.
They look at the media, they look at everything and they see, oh, this light-skinned person, Beyonce, for example, she's looked at as like queen bee, beautiful, light-skinned complexion, blonde hair, and that's looked at as picture perfect.
In the 80s, you know, and early 90s, when I was a kid, a lot of people, you know, the cartoons that they watched or the TV shows that they watched, there were very few instances where people were a darker complexion. And when they were darker complexion, it was rare that they were the good guys. You know, most of the time they would be the bad guys.
I don't think people will admit.
All right, round of applause.
Very good.
Okay. Comments, suggesting feedback? Go ahead, Ramit.
Then
Ronald.
Okay, whatever.
Mm-hmm. I feel you should add some lighter people in there.
There's a few lighter people. I mean, that's not all the clips, that's why.
Yeah, just a work in progress. Just to get some
I just want to say that. I love very much the way you frame it. I think it's very good. I think you have, and I was surprised when you went vroom, vroom, zoom in. I was like, whoa, shit, no, don't. Because in a way, it's great, and I like the way that you frame it on a chair, you know, like this. I mean, and then towards the end, you frame yourself like this, but otherwise, at the beginning, everybody's framed. It's consciously, right? You do it consciously, I presume. And there is, they put the left of the screen and the right of the screen, never in the center, a bit like Errol Morris. You've seen the movies of Errol Morris, the filmmaker. You don't know Errol Morris? You have to watch the documentaries of Errol Morris. Is this the kind of thing that you do in college, is to actually get a body of understanding of what's come before you? You have to know what's before you move on in this world. You have to have a little respect for the past. So instinctively, I love your style. I love the backdrop, the background. So I'm talking about the form, not the content. The content is obviously powerful and strong, but I have to tell you, as a white European living in New York, I'm a white American, I find that it's hard to move me in the age of Obama, to tell American people what you're telling me now about this, which I'm sure is your reality, that it is true that being black, dark black or lighter black or white black, all the things you say about this, I'm sure you're right. I mean, but it's old news. That doesn't mean that we cannot say it over and over again, especially guys of your generation in the college, but I'd like to maybe know more the context then. Is this the experience that you have, that you, because you've had this experience, so it's very valid and it's extremely, you know, disturbing to hear. I'm just saying, who are you addressing yourself to? Who is this for, this movie?
This basically make everyone aware, but then also, like with the rest of the world, got a lot of clips, but it's to show how it's affecting children also and how they're growing up into this, you know, state of mind because of what's going on now, basically.
Okay. Well, I guess this is something that's, you know, in America, it's such a strong component of this country, you know, racism and all that. I can't appreciate this. I didn't grow up here. But I'm always struck by this American racist. It always comes back and goes back to that. And I'm sure that's the experience that you guys have had in your lives and that you maybe still have right now here. Even though, you know, the majority of the country voted for a black president. But so, you know, fine. It's what's important is your story. Your personal story, what you said about your girlfriend and being pretty or not pretty, or you and your thing and your experience, and you, who's the other person? You, I recognize you. It's you. Right. Right. And you do it without. It's funny, interesting, because some of you are not upset about it. Some of you are more upset about it. So it's interesting to see also the level of how you talk about it. How you all talk about some? You, some have more of a, and some are like, it's the way it is, and that's maybe more what I wanna see to appreciate the fact that it's not a political track. It's not a propaganda movie. I mean, unless that's what you want to do. Again, what is your goal with this?
I mean, I just wanted to make people aware, but I didn't want it to be too serious. I mean, that's why I got people like him who could, you know, lighten the movie and not just watching, like, you know.
Too serious. It is serious. It's a serious issue, and it looks serious, and I don't think it's. But once in a while, you get a funny guy like him.
And I do want you to meet the chief librarian, and he has a couple of films he wants you to look at. And you should see how other filmmakers have approached this topic. I mean, Ronald's right. You need to look at.
But it's a great. I like your style, though. I mean, I have to say, and it's an eternal, universal topic, and it'll always be here, unfortunately. And the way that you did it is very simple and very, very powerful. And very, it's very clear.
And I just want to make sure before the film festival, before June 5th, you get to look at some other works of some other directors who did similar topics. Round of applause for our guests.
Thank you very much.
Sebastian is going to make a.
Thank you for your attention.
Brief presentation from the MediaTek and Film Society. Sebastian, come on up. And then we're all going to take a group picture with Ronald for our. Sebastian's writing a story for the communicator about your visit. Okay, Sebastian, it's all yours. Ronald, you just have to stand right here.
Oh, I have to. Oh, okay.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes. Ronald, on behalf of the Media Technology and Filmmaking Club.
I'm getting a present.
Yes, there we go.
This is some Bronx Community t shirt.
Okay, oh, man, that's cool.
Andreas,
thank you. Thank you, bro. Yeah, thank you very much.